Steno Wale Babu welcomes you. Shorthand dictations in male and female voice from all sources like magazines, speeches and editorials at various speeds up to 120 WPM for various departments like SSC, DSSB, CRPF, Delhi Police, etc. Please like, share and subscribe the channel. Thank you.
Exercise number 23. The fiscal year now drawing to a close has been a difficult one by any standards. It has been a year of crisis and of crisis management. It has also been a year of great economic challenges and bold new initiatives. When the new government assumed office 8 months ago, we inherited an economy on the verge of collapse. Inflation accelerating rapidly, the balance of payments was in serious trouble. The foreign exchange reserves were barely enough for 2 weeks of imports. Foreign commercial banks had stopped lending to India. Non-resident Indians were withdrawing their deposits. Shortages of foreign exchange had forced a massive import squeeze, which had halted the rapid industrial growth of earlier years and had produced negative growth rates from May 1991 onwards. Our first and immediate challenge was to arrest the slide and restore India's credibility both domestically and in the eyes of the world. To achieve this objective, we had to make immediate measures to avert a default in international payments and also take steps to restore macroeconomics balance in the economy in the short run with a view to controlling inflation and reducing the balance of payments deficit to a manageable level. Our medium-term objective was to place the economy back on the path of high and sustainable growth. The new government took several initiatives in pursuit of these objectives. We took emergency measures to prevent a default in external payments, which would have been highly disruptive. The previous government had already decided to use a part of the gold held by the Reserve Bank of India to mobilize temporary liquidity abroad. We did not consider it prudent to reverse this decision, but we promised to redeem the gold at the earliest opportunity, and we have kept our word. We began the process of restoring macroeconomics balance by seeking to reduce the fiscal deficit, which had grown very large in the previous year. We also embarked on a medium-term program of structural reform, including new initiatives in trade policy and industrial policy aimed at improving the efficiency, productivity, and international competitiveness of Indian industry. Our longer-term objective is to evolve a pattern of production which is labor-intensive and generates larger employment opportunities in productive higher income, jobs, and reduces the disparities in income and wealth between rural and urban areas, which is very much essential now. Stabilization and structural adjustment are never painless or quick, especially when we are dealing with imbalances and structural rigidities which have built up over several years to bring the economy back to a path of rapid and sustainable growth. A firm commitment to austerity, the pursuit of excellence, and the promotion of efficiency and productivity for the benefit of the common people has to be an integral part of this effort. Given our limited resources, our people cannot afford to copy the soulless consumerism and the wasteful life styles of the affluent countries of the West. Conspicuous consumption has to be actively discouraged. The virtues of thrift have to be emphasized. The owners of wealth, as Gandhiji used to say, must learn to regard themselves as trustees of society. We cannot postpone structural reform and adjustment, but we must ensure that the burden of adjustment on the poorer and weaker sections of our society is reduced to the maximum possible extent. We are traveling through difficult and uncharted terrain where no action is without attendant risks, and success will not always be immediate. We need patience, perseverance, and national cohesion if we are to succeed. It has been allegedly and by some people that the reform program has been dictated by the IMF and the World Bank. We are founder members of these two institutions, and it is our right to borrow from them when we need assistance in support of our programs. As lenders, they are required to satisfy themselves about our capacity to repay loans, and this is where conditionality comes into the picture. All borrowing countries hold discussions with these institutions on the viability of the programs of which assistance is sought. We have also held such discussions. The extent of conditionality depends on the amount and the type of assistance sought. However, I wish to state categorically that the conditions we have accepted reflect no more than the implementation of the reform program as outlined by letters of intent sent to the IMF and the World Bank are wholly consistent with our national interests. The bulk of the reform program is based on the election manifesto of our party. There is no question of the government ever compromising our national interests of our policies, which take time to materialize. I am happy to report to the House that we have made substantial progress even in this short space of 8 months, restoring India's credibility and pulling the economy back from the slide into financial chaos. Thank you.